joy with Bulldog Tours.
Take your time.
All right, I'm going to drop this since only Randy is around. We're at Cicular Congregational Church's graveyard. They've been doing improvements inside the graveyard during this time, and they have some magnificent flowers pointed here. Since my subject is quite so dark, we figured we would counterbalance that with natural beauty. So as I talk about how Charlestonians have died over the centuries, Randy is going to be looking at beautiful flowers. So as soon as I get the thumbs up from Randy that we've got people on, we will go ahead and get started. We started a minute or so early. All right, so guys, I'm gonna get started. Nicely done, St. Philip. So, we'll wait for the bells. That's part of the charm of Charleston, is that you can still hear the bells every day here in the city. All right, guys, so come on inside with me. While researching death records for ghost stories, I came across recognizable causes of death, like cancer and cardiac events and kidney disease. But I also came across some stuff that I had no idea in the world what it was. I came across entries like visitation of God, which is actually a natural cause of death that is unknown. Mania apatu, which is madness from drinking. Coup de soleil, sunburn, and nervous prostration. Extreme exhaustion from the inability to control either physical or mental activity. There was also ample evidence of known epidemics. But there were also large numbers of people who died due to diseases I had no idea killed that many people here in the city. One caught my eye, something called the 9-day disease. What is the 9-day disease? What disease killed 200 children in a 3-year period in the 1860s? Believe it or not, lockjaw. So how in the world were babies getting lockjaw? Why were babies dying of lockjaw in the first 9 days of their life? Because they had either gotten it from their mothers or their umbilical stumps had become infected. So, in the same period, in the 1866 to 1868, every single person who died of gangrene was black. Gangrene used to be called mortification. I had to find a list of old disease names so I could figure out what these people died from. I learned that marasmus was malnutrition, that spotted fever, ship fever, jail fever, and camp fever were typhus, which is caused by lice. I found out that bad blood, French pox, and great pox is syphilis, which was treated in the 17th through 19th centuries with either mercury pills or mercury injected with a urethral syringe. Since we are in the middle of a pandemic, which is a large number of people dying from the same disease across the world, I'm going to stick with the infectious diseases and the epidemics that were caused by those. So things like smallpox, influenza, consumption, measles, and cholera. Infectious diseases are caused by viruses, bacteria, parasites, and fungi. They are spread by either direct contact, touch, exchange of bodily fluids through the placenta or in droplets, or indirect contact, airborne transmission, contaminated objects, food and drinking water, animal to person contact, insect bites, and some of these diseases were even in the soil. There's a saying here in Charleston, Charleston in the spring is a paradise. In the summer, it's a hell. And in the fall, it's a graveyard. So as we walk through this beautiful graveyard here, just remember that a lot of these people lost their lives due to epidemics here in the city. We know a lot of epidemics hit in the summer. We know now that that's because of mosquitoes, but they didn't know in the 1600s and 1700s, even into the 1800s. Now, malaria, which is also called swamp sickness, ague or bilious fever, was one of the first things that the settlers encountered when they stepped off the boat, thanks to mosquitoes. There may have been an epidemic as early as 1671, a year before they landed here. But there were documented epidemics in 1684, 1709, and 1711. And then it stops killing people in large numbers. 1711 was a bad year here in Charleston, because there were also epidemics of smallpox, yellow fever, or variola, and influenza. In 1697 to 98, smallpox, variola, killed 200 settlers out of a population of 5,000. Smallpox epidemics popped up 7 times between 1718 and 1763. It stopped for a while and then it hit again in 1816. The first vaccine for smallpox was developed in 1796 and it became compulsory vaccine in 1905. It was responsible for the decline of Native Americans here in South Carolina from 10,000 in the year 1685 to 300 in 1790. Diphtheria, or putrid fever, or bladder in the throat, was a horrible disease that actually killed over half of the people that were diagnosed with it until an antitoxin was discovered in 1892. It became a vaccine in 1920. What happened in diphtheria, why they called it bladder in the throat, is that this mucus membrane would form at the back of the throat, making it difficult for people to breathe. It also caused heart issues and nerve damage. Consumption, or tuberculosis, was the leading cause of death in America at the start of the 20th century. It was called the Great White Plague because of the paleness of its sufferers. From 1819 to 1845, almost 3,000 people died from TB here in the city. 1821 to 28 saw approximately 1,100 people pass. Tuberculosis, I didn't know this, could actually spread to other areas like the neck and the lymph nodes in the leg. That's called scrofula, or King's Evil, back in the day. In 1836, in 4 months, cholera killed almost 400 people here in the Charleston area, the majority of which were slaves. The most well-known and common epidemic here in the city was yellow fever, also known as the black vomit, stranger's disease, dock fever, bronze John. Yellow fever comes from mosquito bites. It is believed to have been introduced by the slave trade from Africa. There was a belief that Africans were immune to the disease. However, the only place that yellow fever still exists in the world today is Africa and South America. Seaport cities like Charleston were especially hard hit. There was actually a pest house out on Sullivan's Island where the sick were quarantined. The first yellow fever epidemic was reported in 1699 and it killed 15% of the population. There were at least 28 epidemics of yellow fever between 1699 and 1824, with many more that followed after that. The 1858 epidemic is considered to be the worst that we've had, with about 800 people dying. During the peak, the death rate was more than 20 deaths a day. The city resorted to trench graves to meet the demand. Now, in the 1700s, it was a custom that you would ring a church bell when somebody in the city passed. During an epidemic of yellow fever in 1736, they finally gave up on that practice because those bells would have been ringing all day and night long as people died from epidemics here. The last epidemic of yellow fever was in 1877 in Beaufort, Port Royal. Yellow fever was called the stranger's disease because it targeted new immigrants to the area. Locals tended to have an immunity to it. There is no cure for yellow fever, but there has been a vaccine for over 80 years, which offers lifetime protection. The last disease I'm going to talk about is influenza, and in particular, the Spanish influenza pandemic of 1918-1919. It's called the Spanish flu only because a Spaniard was the first person that wrote about it. I was stunned by the similarities of this pandemic to the one that is currently happening. Down to the arguments about when to lift quarantines and the balancing act between business, economics, and public health. It has an important lesson about lifting quarantines prematurely. The first case in Charleston of the Spanish flu was on September 16, 1918, at Charleston Naval Training Station. When medical officers inspected all of those sailors, they found 350 cases just in that one location. A few days later, the Army announced a raging epidemic in Columbia at Camp Jackson. Within just 6 weeks, 412 soldiers had died there. Besides the growing concern about this flu, Charleston was also in the middle of a typhoid epidemic caused by milk tainted by unsterilized bottles. By early October, there were 350 cases of flu in Charleston with one fatality. At that, CFC dismissed the whole student body. The Citadel had actually closed down September 29th because it tended to run through military installations and they were afraid for the students. By October 5th, the city had closed all public and private schools, churches, theaters, movie houses, and had prohibited social gatherings and meetings. In one day, October 8th, 1918, there were 132 new cases. By the way, yesterday, the state reported 226 new cases. Women were asked to volunteer as nursing staff because they'd taken courses about home nursing. Not very many volunteered. Late October saw about 5,500 cases here in Charleston. We were at 6,489 cases as of yesterday with 267 fatalities in the state. Officials in 1918 suspected that the real numbers were double what was being reported. Whiskey was sanctioned as a curative. Yep, I'm not making this up, folks. So what would happen is the bootleg whiskey that had been confiscated by the police was given to doctors to give out to their patients. Actually, you could get some whiskey yourself if you had a prescription. They wrote prescriptions for whiskey during the Spanish flu epidemic here. Now, people would stand in line daily for their curative quart of whiskey. Sometimes they had to wait for hours and hours in that line. So the new cases started to wane. Ours, by the way, are not waning. They're still on the uptake. And the quarantine was lifted at midnight on November 6th. Kids were out of school for another week, but their Christmas vacation was cut from 10 days to 3 days. They were actually sitting in class on New Year's Day that year. Prior to lifting the quarantine, the lone doctor that was consulting the city had warned that reopening was foolish, but the clergy and business leaders won out. The city declared business as usual. And I found this quote and I have to share it with you. And I did not make it up. It was said, "On with the dance. Let joy be unconfined." Well, by January of 1919, there were another 1,000 cases. So the quarantine was reinstated. This time that doctor doubled down. He called for a cancellation of all social affairs. He even put up signs on the doors of people who were infected with that flu. By early February, the cases had started to drop again. The cases started to drop. And so the quarantine was lifted again. The influenza pandemic of 1918 and 1919 has to be said because it encompassed 2 years because the quarantine was lifted and people became infected again. That pandemic killed 30 to 50 million people worldwide. Now, when you look at this pandemic here in our state and in our country, you think it's not too bad. We're at like 60 whatever thousand people across the U.S. have died. But what finally occurred to me is every single person that has been in an ICU unit or on a ventilator would have been a death back in 1918, 1919. So we have to remember that even though our numbers aren't bad, we are leaps and bounds ahead of what medicine was at the beginning of the 1900s. Now, the mask was heralded as the savior from the Spanish influenza, and salvation was through rigorous hand washing and limiting exposure to crowded spaces. Does that sound familiar to anybody? Certainly did to me. Epidemics and pandemics reveal human nature, cultural prejudices, inequality in medical care, and gaps in public policy. But they also can bring societies to action. They can change public health, which is what happened here in Charleston after that 1918-1919 pandemic. And also it creates breakthroughs in medical science. Real quickly, I want Randy to flip around here. You see this empty space? According to local or oral legend, there's a trench grave that held 250 yellow fever victims. They died so quickly, the city certainly couldn't keep up with digging graves. So they resorted to things like trench graves, where they could put huge numbers of people in a fairly small space. So I'm actually done. Thank you all for sticking with that. I know it was long. I know some of it was technical, but I wanted to share a couple things. One, the crazy things that killed Charlestonians. Teething killed hundreds of children. This lockjaw killed hundreds of children. Aren't we glad we don't live in the 1718 or early 1900s anymore? Luckily for us, lessons were learned by those epidemics, by that pandemic, so that we're alive today, but we're facing another pandemic. So what I'm really interested to see is what changes after this is all over. Do we change our behavior? Does medical science advance so much that we have a vaccine and we don't ever have to worry about COVID-19 ever again in our lifetimes? We don't know. But what we do know is we hope all of you are staying healthy. We hope that soon it will be safe for all of us to go out and for all of you folks to come back to Charleston. Because trust me, I'm jonesing big time to give tours again. And I know my fellow tour guides are as well. But what today's video is about is recovery. There will be recovery. We're not sure what it looks like, but there will be recovery. And Charleston will probably come back better than it's ever been before. Thank you guys so much. I hope you enjoyed this very dark subject. Hopefully I made it interesting for you. Tune in all next week, where Randy tomorrow is actually doing a video on Portacow School. When I first met Randy, I really thought that him pronouncing Portacow School was Portacow. I was very confused as to where he went to school. But tune in to his video. It too will be talking about that. We also have one coming up on the Citadel. So thank you guys so much. Have a great day. Get out, enjoy some sunshine at 6 feet away.